It's a favorite song of mine, but in this video, I just want to go through some of the chords, look at some of the changes of how he changed the original version. And so let's move really, really quickly here. So in the original version, I want to look at where he changed the key. Mostly now, always listen to the original so we can know what he's improvising from. Okay, so as you can see, maybe you can't. Let me go backwards a little bit. It's in the key of D. Yeah, D flat. Now, I want to make some comments here about what's that change, because they're moving it a half step up. And so, all right, so let me go move this out the way here. So we're in the key of D flat, and then they're doing a series of chords that go, actually, and then now they're on that. Now, because remember the song, the lift those hands, they start on the 2. Right, so he's gonna start in an E flat if he's in the key of D flat, but if he's in the key of D, they wanna start on an E. So the progression has to make sure that you land on that E. One of the things that, and bringing in an interesting point here, because basically the movements that he's doing here, these four chords, you can look at it as being progressions, maybe using even the circle of fifths, because on the first progression he's using, and because the circle of fifths can help you really to find out a lot of things, and I'm just going to use progressions as one of them. If I know I want to land on a D, then I hit, you know, I can hit an E and an A as these are the bass notes. Chords, you know, that will correspond to that will help to figure that out. So I want you to look at what he hits, because basically what we're hitting here is, now I want this in view. Let me move this out the way really quick, because I want to show something here. I wonder if this one will let me play it at the same time. Anyway, I'll just do it an octave higher. So we're going, so here's the E, A. So these would be good chords to use, E and A, if we were about to go to the key of D. But then he switches it, which are the leading chords, to E, to that note. No, I'm sorry, not the key, but the note. So E, A would be, but it's E, A, but the D is not played, and then you have an F sharp and a B. Okay, so, and I hope I'm explaining, this in a way that you understand. My point is that if you're going to play a D, you can use a circle of fifths as, to give you suggestions on some passing chords to get to that note. Right, and so you can use, and I'm just saying for this one, you can use the 2 before it. Okay, going counterclockwise. So basically, he wants to end up on an E. So E, A, which is implying that he could be using that D, but then he switches F sharp, B, and now he's back there. So that's how they do it in the original. But what I want to do is show what Derrick Jackson did. Let me see here. See, it's the same thing. which is why knowing the chords is critically important, because he's using the same pattern. I don't know if you hear that. All right, so let me show you. All right, and I got a lot of stuff going on here. Okay, but let's show you that he's using that pattern. I'm gonna bring this forward just a tiny bit. He's still in this original key. Now he's about to make the change. He's on the D flat. E, A, F sharp, B. All right, lift those hands. Okay, so again, what he's doing, even though the chords are fatter, he's not changing the chord of progression, and it's clear that he knows this song, right? He's not changing the song so much to where he's changing all the chords. He's maintaining the structure of the song by following that pattern. So he's going... That's when he hits that E flat. I would do that one, and then lift those hands and bless him. And then when he goes into that, now let me let you hear something here. And I know that there's some of you are hearing a little bit of dissonance there. As you can see in the MIDI file, there is no bass note at that part, right? Lift those hands. That chord there, no bass. You're hearing a little dissonance there too. Let me let you hear that. Now, so that chord would be, yeah, that's a C major 9. So he's going. And you see how nice it sounds clustered there? Gives you a nice voicing there. Remember the C major 9, and I taught you that last week's video. We said that you could just bring the 9 in, and it gives you that nice clustered sound. You could, if you wanted to make it more dissonant, throw in an E flat there. But if you throw in an E flat, you got to get rid of one of these two notes, right? So, or you could do that, and I may like that one better. So let's try that. See that? And because remember, what I'm doing is I'm keeping in mind what my bass note is. So that it would be. So because that E flat is part of the dominant seventh chord, that's the reason I said that it could work in there, because he's just doing it like that. But he could make that and see, and it still works in a minor second, giving most of the dissonance in that chord structure. All right, now let's keep on going. Okay, so that part there. Let me let you hear it in context. Let me go backwards. Let me actually let you listen. Let me let you hear what he does first. Oh. Let me see, that sounds like what he's doing. I don't know, I've never. Ah, I see. Okay, so nice change there. Alright, so what he's doing. So what they're doing is, and he, you know, get that E there for that nice, you know, six sound there. So, you know, that's just the F dominance. right? And then when you get to that chord, get the B there. Now, but what's going on with the Derrick Jackson, all these musicians have similar names, so it's... Yeah. Nice. See, it's so obvious that he understands the chord structure because he's still ending on that G7-13, but it's instead of going, you know, he's doing, okay, so again, and, you know, if you were playing it on the organ and only wanted to voice that, you know, without the bass note, it would be. Right? Because I'm thinking of, in my head, I'm playing a C sharp. And then a C. And then a G. You know, have that tone, they'll have those tones in my head so I can make sure that the chords do match. Now let me keep on going here. I want to get to those end progressions. Can you wear your arms? No. Thank you, Jesus. Sweet. Okay, so it's getting to the end here. Okay, I want to get these last chords. Now. This is where he does a lot of his fancy chord. I like the progression. Do not start playing these chords. A lot of problem with beginning musicians is they just jump straight to trying to improvise without having any sense of structure of what the chords are. Can you sing the chords? Can you play the... No, I'm sorry. Can you not sing the chords? Can you sing the bass notes? If you can't sing the bass note there, then you shouldn't be playing the bass note. It starts with singing it, not necessarily out loud. You know, you can sing it in your head, but you have to know what those notes are. All right, so let's do it. Now we gotta follow that structure. And you just keep doing that over and over. And if you know it really good, you should be able to do it in any key. Right, because it won't matter what key it is, because you're going to understand the pattern. Okay, so now, chord-wise, now we can put the chords on there. And let's see, and again, what I want to do is kind of compare what he did to what the original was doing. All right, so let's go. These will just give you some ideas for some chord progressions. Lord, I praise you without reservation. Right now, way down in my spirit, I love you. All right, so basically, you want to learn these chord progressions. And again, don't rush through them. Know each one of them. So you have the... Alright, so we have the... So I would just have it as a... think of this as a D chord on top with an E on bottom. Let's make this real simple. Do a D chord with an E on bottom. Then walk down your next note. Do the same chord. And then think of an A major chord. But put the C sharp on the bottom. Put the A on top. And then, you know, maybe you can double up on the C sharp there. So here we have it. Okay. The next chord is going to be a Actually, I would use that. So then go back to a D chord, and then do a C minor 7. Okay, so from the beginning. And then what I want you now, remember this bass is walking down. So we're supposed to be hitting a B next. Hit a C diminished here. Okay, and then, all right, let's go from there. Nope. I skipped the A major. I still did a C diminished. I add the seventh, but the quality is the same. And then I want you to add just see it as a B minor chord, but it's inverted because the F sharp is down there, and then hit an A on the bottom, which is, they're calling it a D major 6 because the D major 6 would be this chord. But I'm just see it as that. Okay, and then all right, let's go from that. I'm doing one at a time, trying to go really slow here. That dissonance is coming from that B flat there, from the dominant there. Okay, and then where am I at on the diminished? And then a G major 7th. Or you, if you want to do this one again, remember we already did that. You can, really the only thing that's moving is the bass note. So if you want to do it that way, you can. And then now I'm gonna give you two different options for this F sharp when it goes to the F sharp. You can just have all white notes, which is really just an F. It's just a D major chord. Just kind of spread it out a little bit. Okay, so that would sound like this. But if you notice, there's no dissonance in that. What will give it the dissonance is if this D moves to a E flat, which changes everything. No. Here, see how that sounds? Because now we have a lot of things going on. We have a dominant 7. We have that dominant sound there. We had bringing the D up to the E flat creates the tritone with the E and the A. So just that, and that's how changing one note sometimes changes the entire structure of the chord. But you got to know what you're doing. You don't want to just be changing notes. You got to know why you're changing the note. And in that case, gives it that dissonance that we want. And if you listen to,
Lord, I praise you without reservation. Right now, way down in my spirit,
hear that? And they're hitting that on the F sharp. So right? And of course, you can spread them out, you know. Now, if I wanted to, now right now I'm not spreading them. I'm just kind of playing the basics, but without changing any of the quality, it's still the same thing, right? I'm still keeping the structure. Same chord, still that A, I just spread it out now. Right? Right? Same chord. I'm still thinking of a diminished with the B on there. Right. Where was I at? There. And then, right, giving that same E flat there. Now this is just an ideas of not really changing too much, because it's kind of you gotta have to know where you're coming from before you ever make a change, so that I know that I am keeping intact the artist's original intent, especially if I'm accompanying a choir. Now, but I want to go over his change and what he does. So let's look at that. Now, I wanted to show you the original first. Those are the original chords, so that we know why what he's doing is so incredible, and then to kind of look at some of the changes that he made. So let's look at that now. I think I don't need this anymore, so let's cut that off. Okay, so where is he at? I think this is right before that progression. Oh, by the way. Oh. Cause that's just a movement to get to that. But what he's trying to do is he's getting to that chord there. So that's the movement that he's doing to get to that chord. Here it is. Here's it. Ah, there's a progression. Ah, okay. You know what? Here's what I want to do. I think I want to bring in a quiz right here. We're going to bring in the ear, because remember, I'm all about ear development. I'm hearing a difference. I'm hearing a difference already, but it's a very, very subtle difference. Okay, so let me go back to the original. Remember, we said this is in the original, we just do this. So my question is, what is he doing differently? And it's only one note. Check it out. Do it again. So what note is different? That's the original chord. What's he adding? Now, how do I test this without making it about perfect pitch? There is really no way to do it, because how about this? Is he adding a C sharp? I'll let you hear how it sounds. Is he adding a C? Is he adding a B? Or is he... I'm not going to put an A, because the A is being played up here. Or is he adding a B flat? But listen to it. Some people are going to try to answer this by guessing. And I want you to answer this by using your ear. Now, first thing we got to do is sing that tone. Okay, let me sing the tone that I'm hearing in there. Watch this. Da, da. Do you hear that? Listen to it. Da, da, da. Hear it? Da. See, it you hear it clearly when I'm singing with it. Hear it again. Da, da. Okay, so now that's different, because in Thomas Whitfield version, that buh is not being played. So what is that buh note, right? So maybe there is a way I can look at it without doing perfect pitch. We can still use relative by what you got to do is kind of train your ear to kind of pretend these notes don't exist, and duh, you could probably hear that that's a perfect fifth, right? Because because you should be able to hear perfect fifths. I think you should be able to hear that. But what the hard part is, because what people do is they're saying, well, I can't, you know, you must have perfect pitch because you knew that that is a B. Oh, by the way, the answer is a B, but I'm going to keep on going. You knew that that's a B, but in reality, how do you know that I'm not just, I just know what an E perfect fifth sounds like. So it's not so much that I know what B is, but that I know what a perfect fifth is. You see what I'm saying? But let me keep on going. See, now you hear it moving down. See, because now that my ear is focused on that note, that's going to help me with these chords. Da, 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 see, it's my ear is helping me with that. Da, da. But would that make sense, though? Because when we were doing this, remember, we did that, and then we hit the da. So that's why that B is going to move down there, because you're not going to play that B with that, the B flat, with the B here. So the only difference, then, with what he did in the original would be that we're adding the B there. So let's now do the exact same thing we did for the first three chords and simply add a B in them. Same thing. So in actuality, he's not adding a whole lot to the original progressions. Remember, we already said that that was a C diminished over the B. He's not changing that. He has a G, E minor there. Whew, that I just love. I love that sound. Okay, so when he gets the G, I think when we got to G, I think we did a G major seventh. But he's going. I love that because if you listen to what note, listen to what he's holding on the top. I don't know if you hear that. He's holding that note during the movement, during the change. See, that has to hold. That has to hold to hear the change against that note. The other thing that's holding is the G on the bass. So that is being. So that's what gives it its sound. And this is sound such a nice progression. Look, and it's not a lot of notes. That's such a nice. I gotta write this down. I'll just watch my own video at the end and then copy it that way, because I want this chord. I'm gonna steal this chord. Not the chord, but the movement. It's such a nice movement. Yeah. This is why. See, I am not above any other musician in that I have to practice just like everybody else does. You know. Just because I can hear things doesn't mean that I don't have to practice. If I want to implement this chord progression into my playing, I have to practice it just like everyone else has to practice it. Sit down, do it in every key, and figure out when I can use it. Okay, but I love that progression. Let me just do it one more time, just for kicks. So let me try it, and then get that. And then, yeah, because he has to end on that diminished sound, because that E flat that we said in the last one. Nice. All right, let's keep on going. Same thing. He keeps making... Calm down, Sean. These people gonna kick me out this apartment, man. I know I'm so loud right now. Oh, man. And he keeps making it at the same spot, too. So he's making these... He's making these at that G. Let's see. That was the first one, and now he's doing something else. All right, so I'm gonna go figure that. Let me say, does he do that anywhere else? I'm gonna keep on playing. And he's just fattening him up now. He's not changing it. Okay, that makes sense. Okay, so he only did those movements twice, and I don't know if you have. I don't know if you remember, I told you that I thought last week that Corey Henry had gotten that movement from this video because he had said that he had studied Derrick Jackson, and I assumed that maybe he had gotten that movement from, and some of you are probably wondering what I was talking about. Let me show you what I mean, at least what my ear says. It was in part two, Corey Henry. Where does he make it? Yeah, here it is. Here it comes up. Here it is. That. There it is. That's what I was... Okay, so let me compare that against this. Uh-huh. See, listen. That's where I'm hearing it. I don't know if you're hearing it. But here's a perfect example of someone who, in my mind, now I don't know this, okay? But my mind took, okay? Because it's not copying. People stop saying musicians are copying. I get so sick of people saying that. Musicians transcribing is how musicians learn. There is no musician. Name any great musician, and they all will have studied someone before them, note for note. That's what you do. Okay, you're supposed to copy. Okay, you are supposed to copy. You're supposed to do it note for note, chord for chord. That is what transcribing is. Okay. So, you know, in my mind, Corey already knows what I'm showing y'all right now. And since he was 20 when he made this, he probably knew this for a long time ago, okay? But that's what it is, all right? All right, and I know I'm ranting and raving right now, but listen to the chord progression here that Derrick Jackson did. He's doing it a little bit, and then when you hear it here, now check this out. Now I don't know if you're hearing that. I think that movement was derived from that, okay? Only because he says that because when an artist says to you, when he says, okay, when Corey himself says that he studied Derrick Jackson, who I'm sharing with you has a progression that sounds like Corey, what do you think? Where do you think he got it from? I mean, come on. How... I can't get any more clear. All right. I'm going to calm down. I'm not even going to show that progression because now I'm up. I don't even know why I'm upset now. Get the MIDI file and figure out those notes. Okay. Corey learned it from him. And now you can learn it from the MIDI file. Let me come backwards. Let me come backwards here, and actually, he does it. He does it twice, though. Hold on. Oh, there it is. Oh, he does it twice. Oh, those are some sweet. Oh, those are so sweet. You're gonna have to put that in the MIDI file or the group I'm developing. If you got an email from me, it's not open to everybody. I'm doing an exclusive membership. And please don't ask me in the comments, because the email's already gone out. Those of you who check your email, this is only invitation only for the first set of people. But I'll probably put that in there for them, of course. Anything I don't put on YouTube is gonna go to them. So I'll probably put that for them. Yeah, I'll do that. But everybody else, get that MIDI file. Alright, now I wanna show you, let me see here. There is something I wanted to show. Just one more thing before I end this video. I may have to pause it and come back. Yeah, let me pause it, find it, and come back. Basically, it's right after he changes the key, and it's something that really I wanted to make a note of. Right here. All right, now that part there. So now I want to show you something. What he's using there, I like what he's doing, because later on in the video, and I'm not going to probably have time to do that today, but basically he's showing that by keeping the bass note the same. Go watch the original video. I'll put a link on there. But he says that you can change the chords, you know, and just alter the chords and see what works with one bass note. But I find this interesting in that he's doing the opposite here. So what I want you to do is try this. Make it easy for you. Play an F sharp chord and see what notes that work with going down on the bass. Just walk it down. Now, that works, and E flat works. Because knowing what works will help you. And I think I'm going to walk them down in sevenths, minor sevenths, okay? That works, right? As a chord, I'm just saying, to your ear, see if it makes sense. That doesn't work for me. That works for me as a chord. That works. I like that, actually. That works. Now, on this one, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to change it to an A flat there. That works. That works. Love the A13th sound. That works. And see, notice each of these gives you a different quality. That works. So what's happening here, I want you to see it, and it may be easy to see it in the MIDI file, but what's happening here, right here. See, now look at this. You see these notes? Just lift those hands and bless. Look at how that's changed. Look at how that's remaining the same. In actuality, I could have, if I wanted to, just have extended this note. And this chord here is a da da da. You recognize that as a major chord, right? Which is just. And notice that the only thing that's changing are the bass notes, but what is giving it its sound so basically all he's doing, and I want you to watch the sound, is so let me let you hear this in context. I don't want to lose. I And I love it. See, it seems like, it sounds like he's doing something so fancy, but in reality, the left hand isn't changing. Now watch this. See, that chord is beautiful. Let's add the E flat in there. That sharp 11 is gonna give that a nice. Watch this. Now watch this. See that? I didn't change anything except the left hand a half step down. Added the E in there from what I told you earlier and gives you some beautiful sounding chords. Right? Nice. Really, really nice. Okay, so again, I wanted to kind of show you that technique, you know, but you kind of have to experiment with it a little bit and just kind of see what works. Hopefully you enjoyed this video. I'm not going to do anything at the end. I'm just going to go ahead and end here. For those of you who want the MIDI file, I usually leave that in the description area, or there should be something that pops up on the screen about this. Go study Derrick Jackson. The only way that you are going to grow, you got to have a reference point. Remember, there's got to be mentoring. We don't mentor ourselves. We don't mentor ourselves. If you have the opportunity to have a mentor, actually, in many cases, that's the best thing. And I don't think you should ever get to a place where you think you don't need, that you have arrived. Because at that moment, you will stop growing. Okay? You never, ever, 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 ever want to get to the point where you say, now I know what I need to know. Because it's at that moment that your learning and your growth will stop, and someone else will come and just pass you on by. So always have the attitude of learning, an attitude of humility. As musicians, it's very important, because you know what? No musician knows everything. And really, if you're studying what the way you're supposed to be studying, you know, and you're really focused on learning something deeply, you know, you're just not going to know everything, but you will have your own unique sound, and it can be different from everybody else. So that's my encouragement for you today. Thanks again for watching, and we'll see you later.